And we're following all of the breaking news as the Secretary of State clashes with top Democrats who are demanding to question State Department officials about the Ukraine scandal. Key House committee chairmen are warning Mike Pompeo that his delaying tactics may be used as evidence of obstruction in the impeachment investigation. And now we're learning that the State Department Inspector General is asking for an urgent briefing on Capitol Hill tomorrow. Let's bring in our analysts and our experts. Okay, first let's talk about this State Department IG, who's supposed to be the independent watchdog of the State Department, requesting an urgent Hill briefing. This is, there's a lot of questions we have about this because we just found this out. I mean, what do you want to know?
Well, first of all, according to Kylie's reporting, it's not just this urgent request for a meeting. It's that the way that the request was made was, according to her source, cryptically worded. Could be related to what we saw this morning, which is Mike Pompeo saying in a tweet and in a statement, no, we're not going to play ball. Perhaps people who work for him do want to play ball because they think it's important. And like the whistleblower, they're trying to go through the proper channels, which is what an inspector general is.
And is that what would happen if there's someone who Mike Pompeo does not want testifying,
maybe,
but perhaps they do want to? That's the process they would go through, like the whistleblower and the IC?
That absolutely could be. Look, it's also important to remember that Congress isn't there. So for the inspector general to think that it is so urgent that they're, you know, trying to get in touch with staff and maybe some members who they can who he can reach out to on the phone or at least through staff. I mean, this is highly, highly unusual.
It's very unusual.
And just look at how many committees are going to be briefed. The committee staff from House Foreign Affairs, Senate Foreign Relations, House and Senate Appropriations, House Oversight, Senate Homeland Security, Senate Intelligence. Those are a lot of people.
And far broader than where the impeachment inquiry is,
correct,
obviously.
Yeah.
Although,
correct,
weirdly, is not House Intelligence is not on that list.
I think it is.
Oh, it is
it
on
is.
The list. Okay.
It is on the
take
list.
Take it back.
All right, take it back. Okay, so as we see the Secretary of State trying to delay these depositions by these key Ukraine witnesses, we're still going to hear from, or we're not, but Congress is still going to hear from Kurt Volker, the envoy, the former envoy to Ukraine, who resigned and therefore is now able to testify. This is, I mean, he's going to provide some pretty interesting information.
Well, you know, if you maybe remember Rudy Giuliani on Fox holding up his phone,
that's right,
saying, look, I got text from Volker. Volker said it was great that I was
it's
working.
It's now on our phones, too.
That's right. It's the official text. I don't think Volker could have been too happy about that. Basically, Giuliani saying, look, this is the person who gave me permission. He wants to explain, presumably, what his relationship was with Giuliani. The other thing to know about Volker is that this is someone who is not a Trump person. He's not an Obama person. He is a highly respected diplomat who is not known as a political person. And I think whatever he says, if he's allowed to speak, will carry a lot of weight, because I think people in both parties trust him a lot.
He's really an American person, if you will.
His position at the McCain Institute may sort of explain the approach he takes to this. I do think, in addition, he's going to be the first person we hear from, not named Rudy Giuliani, to actually explain from the State Department side about all of the contacts with Ukraine. He would know, right? I mean, he would know what the State Department was working on and how the administration was contacting Ukraine. And I think that he wants to do not just whatever Giuliani said about him in his text, but I think he wants to set the record straight more broadly about the administration, the State Department's approach to Ukraine in its entirety.
Sean, what do you think?
Look, you know, I think that with regard to these depositions, you know, these depositions have the potential to be extremely important to this. And I say they have the potential to be because as I'm thinking about what Volker is going to say when he goes up there, and I think about the other four individuals who were mentioned in this whistleblower complaint, you know, it's in order to get meaningful and factual and clear information out of them, they're going to need to be questioned in a kind of dispassionate, you know, objective and fair way. And my concern at this point is that it's, you know, it's great that Volker's going up there. I think he's going to try to make a case to defend himself as well as the others. But my real concern here is how important these are is going to really depend on how well the members of Congress do at questioning these individuals. And, you know, and Brianna, I just want to make one point on
that. They've shown that they're challenged, Sean, in that regard at times when we've seen
in public
where you think that they would have spent time preparing. The questions have been lackluster.
Yeah, they absolutely have. Look, they spend more time editorializing. And you know, as Nancy Pelosi said, if this is not about politics, if this is just about this impeachment inquiry, then they need to not do that. But, you know, on this inspector general over the State Department, it's important to point out that this inspector general is unlike any other inspector general in government. This is one of the most independent and far removed inspector generals in all of government. And so this is someone who doesn't deal on a daily basis, isn't inside the agency, and oftentimes doesn't have those same loyalties to the agency that others, truly independent. So that's one of the reasons why this is really interesting, because this is somebody who, for all intents and purposes, is outside of the agency.
David, you have Democrats who have looked at this transcript, the whistleblower complaint, and they say this is the smoking gun. So if they have the smoking gun, how much more do they need to sort of pad it with context to take this thing to the bank?
I think the Democrats have a burden to bring the American people along with them on this journey. I think that's sort of the political burden on them here. And so you can understand they don't want to just, we have the smoking gun, the next day impeach, he's acquitted in the Senate and it's done. I mean, they do want to build a case. But I would just argue that you are right. And it's not just Democrats saying that. I mean, we all read the rough transcript for ourselves, right? I mean, it's unlikely more damaging information is going to come out than the president's own words and what his White House put out in that transcript in this process. And so, yes, context is key, but I do think it is why you saw Nancy Pelosi also say to keep this narrowly focused, to do it on an expeditious, an expedited schedule. It's because the thrust of what they're pursuing is already in the public domain.